I'm going to talk about the test and grades, that is the examination part, what we normally conduct as such. I have been chairman and vice chairman for JEE and GATE examinations, and that also has given me some added inputs for this kind of lecture out here. Certainly what exactly is done in GATE or JEE is not going to be talked about, but certainly otherwise also I would like to take hints from what we have been doing out there and try to see if our grading gets improved, the setting up of our tests gets improved as such. Today we'll be moving with this particular aspect as such, and get going. The whole group, if I am not mistaken, is with the engineering background as such. As you just now came to know, I am from mechanical background as such, and maybe a few examples which may come in may not be to liking of people from other disciplines, but to that extent I can't help it as such. I will try to keep the thing simple and go for that particular kind of arrangement as such. The presentation today is going to look at these different aspects as such. I am just going to briefly introduce the topic as such, the different types of problems which we normally come across, not only while setting the problems, but even during conducting the tests, and what kind of additional precautions one has to take if the test is to be conducted in a proper and very smooth fashion as such. Once we conduct the test, the immediate next process which comes in is the assessment process as such, and that also as a bearing on the students' final futural things as such. And so one has to give enough importance not only to conduct the test, but also how to exactly assess that particular paper or something. And all these studies which we are going to look at, they are nothing very specifically from me alone. There are enough inputs which I got, and some of them are going to give us the requirements in the form of setting up the question papers or questions as such, and it's going to have a lot of implications on the further things, not only on the teacher's part as such, but also for the student. So both ways it's going to be important, and would like to have that part considered. When we talk about certain things, we also feel that at times the students have not understood the concepts as such, and not understanding is one part, understanding it in a wrong way makes it more difficult as such, and that's what we are calling as misconceptions out here as such. So that part also will be saying exactly what kind of problems the students face, some small examples also I'll be talking about out there as such, and then we'll be looking at this taxonomic scheme of problem solving as such. I'll not define this particular term out here, but as we move on, at the time we will take it up in more details as such. The problems when we set, again there has to be some particular thinking going into that problem setting part as such. It's not making a question paper of six questions or six questions with A and B, giving some options within them. It's not only that, there is something more to that which will have to be thought of as such. And then again, the feedback to students, which is something which one has to know and do it in a proper way. Otherwise, whatever efforts you put in as a teacher or as an examiner for a particular person, the efforts may turn out to be totally futile as such. Nothing may come out of that, because the student doesn't get the feedback. You conduct the next exam and he will again give the response exactly on the same lines as he did the first time as such. So this, we have the different types of problems and the tests to be conducted. We even have to start setting a tutorial sheet as such. In IIT also we have the same practice, we have the tutorials conducted after certain portion is covered, or after 2 weeks a certain time period is set. And I'm not looking at setting questions for that as something different from examination part as such. Because there also, when we are looking at this aspect, our intention is to get something out from them, and at the same time to know what exactly we have put in effort for their understanding, how much has been accepted, how much has been realized actually, how much has finally gone into the head and what is not remaining only on paper as such. So that aspect is the one which brings us to a tutorial sheet kind of question. Once we say that we have set the questions, we leave the whole thing to the students how to solve them, and that is again not a very right practice. The students are not trained for solving each and every different type of problem as such. They may have problems at some stage or the other during any particular question. The type of questions and other things we will be looking at little bit later. When we talk about the assessment, there are assessments also on different lines, and a few forms which it will take, we will come to that also later. Let me introduce this as such. As I said, I am aware that all the people out here are from engineering, with engineering background as such, and it makes my job little bit simpler because I have gone through the engineering education, went for the somewhat larger time period because of the M.Tech and PhD as such, and when we talk of PhD, in general one thinks that he is going for a research problem, he doesn't have to answer to anything. It's not like that. Every now and then you have to give progress seminars, progress assessments are there. There again the people are going to ask questions. At some stage or the other, everyone of us will tend to go to that level where you have to look at everything as an examiner or expert in that small area and put the questions to a candidate. And when you are doing all this, there has to be some thinking in the mind as such. And the methods which will be using for evaluation, that has to give us a feedback how much the students have understood and how much part they have not been able to make out as such. So looking at these particular parts as such, let's briefly have a look at what are the different types of tests which we normally come across as such. It's not just the end semester test or the annual examination paper or some such thing. We need to go through large number of evaluations at every point in time. So it's not that everything turns out to be a written test as such. So when we are conducting the VIVA, say in semester quizzes and tests, we are again splitting it as a quiz and a test as such. Here we normally consider the case where the time period is very short, the questions are also short, but something has to again come out of that. Test is a slightly elongated process compared to the quizzes as such. This becomes handy, comes in handy for the regular coursework part as such. But when we give the conduct the experiments in the laboratories, the practicals as we call them, when they conduct the practicals, they are coming out with final results, they submit it, and again the evaluation is not based only on what they submit as such. Evaluation is based again to ensure that they have understood something, something has been grasped what you wanted them to, and from that angle the VIOC is conducted. In most places, as I told earlier, or professor told, that I did my graduation from Amravati Engineering College. Not a very good college, not even that time, but I can't say that people were not good. There were enough good people, good faculty members who brought something into us, and that's why we are out here as such. So it's not that the college didn't have good facilities. College even didn't have its own building. Okay, so forget about the facilities what you can think of as such. It was in a polytechnic building, and a particular floor was given for the engineering college. A few additional experiments set up apart from what were there for the polytechnic students. And so we have come with that background. So in a way, rural background. You can look at it in normal terminology as a rural and urban background. So I am from a rural background in that sense as such. But that has not really made a difference because there were people, a good set of people, more than 50-60% people were good as teachers out there as such. And that was a small place, we didn't have too many industries around, so still we went for a practical tour, they took us to all different places, explained the thing at different locations. So there were a lot of efforts being put, and that's how the things were working. Now of course that college is good, they have got good building and good set of faculty, or many PhDs are all there. I think they're working on well now. But that time was somewhat different. This was slightly disguising from the course part as such. But why I'm putting it is, when YYC is conducted, one has to again look at it in a separate way as such. I attended a part of the last session as such. I didn't attend a full session, but I attended about half an hour, 45 minutes part as such. And I learnt out there whether it should be a group evaluation or an individual evaluation. So both can be done simultaneously. It's not necessary that you must call in one by one and talk to him and get the impressions made as such. The discussion can take place simultaneously. In fact, what I prefer need not be preferred by everyone else. Normally, if it's a group of four, I call them in batches of two each as such. And when I'm asking certain questions, I see the things which are reflected on the face of the other student. At times, he immediately reacts. Even though he is supposed to keep cool and keep mum, he suddenly will jump in that, no, no, sir, this is not correct. This should be like this. So that kind of thing happen, and that interaction in a way helps the students as such. So it's nothing wrong in having a group evaluation, but that group should be a small number. It can't be four people or six people at a time. Then the things may not work. I have seen even that happening even in the final practical examination as such. But that doesn't turn out to be a good practice in that sense. Again, the presentations of students, seminars and projects, these two are again on totally different lines as such. You have not taught them anything. You have maybe helped them in looking at the literature or some such thing. And the idea is also totally different. It's not something which they have to reproduce or some such thing. They have to have a look at, say, maybe 10, 15, 20, depending on how much time is given, how much weightage is given to those seminars as such. And they have to pick up the literature, get involved with that, and try to put the thing so that there is a proper link established between different papers. And not only that, almost every student is in position to do within a paper. But once you have a set of papers available, to put them together and come out with drawbacks and conclusions is something which is very important. And that is the thing which decides in case of M.Tech project or B.Tech project or PhD work, everywhere that helps in what we call as the problem definition. So unless you have the prior information, prior art kind of thing known, one is not in position to decide what exactly should be done now. Because you have been given a problem, but within that, what is to be done and what is not to be done, nothing of that kind is known. So the evaluation also has to be on those lines as such. You can't expect that the conclusions are drawn, so whether the conclusions are correct or not, that can be your opinion. The student may have a different opinion. So chance also has to be given to the student to explain what he feels about this thing. One of the things which I feel about this particular part out here as such, seminars specifically, at times we observe that the student doesn't get a chance to explain the things in a proper way. You ask one question, he is not in position to answer it. Suddenly the other person may switch out to another question. The students are not that ripe as such. They are students. They are going through that process where they can think, and the thinking process, speed of thinking is increasing day by day, but it has not reached the level what you expect from them. And that's going to happen in the beginning. Once they appear for 3-4 seminars or have examinations or things like that, then you will find the change in their attitude, the change in the way they answer the questions and things. So my thinking out here is, when we are looking at these seminars specifically, they need to be given some time to think, maybe half a minute to think and then answer. And in fact, we have a practice out here. When we tell the question, we ask, or rather tell the student, don't try to answer it fast. Think for a moment. You are not going to get a chance to change your answer. But before answering, you are going to get a few seconds as such. Make use of them. Don't start answering before you complete the question, before the examiner completes the questions. They anticipate certainly. Everyone anticipates. because they are, that anticipation is also expected, and that also has to be good as such from a candidate's point of view. But if you anticipate it and before the question is completed, if you try to answer, there are more than 50% chances that the answers are wrong as such. So the student has not heard the question fully and he has started answering, he doesn't know where the question is going to end. So such things also need to be taken into account by faculty, the teachers out here, and that has to be somewhere or the other told to students that this is going to be a arrangement which is going to be there at the time of examination. You have to do it in this fashion, you have to do it in that. So some such things have to be coming in. Coming to a new aspect about the projects as such, there is again a big difference between the seminars and projects. Seminars, as normally we look at from the BTech seminars or MTech seminars, what we expect is just picking up the information which is available as such. There is no personal contribution to that particular part. But when it comes to project, we expect something is being done by the candidate also. It's not that he collects the information and puts it in certain order, gives you a proper conclusion, and there the matter ends. So that becomes only the first part or literature review chapter, as we normally put it in the final form in the MTech report or something. At the end of it, he is expected to come out with certain lacuna in the literature, that this particular thing is not explained properly, or this needs some support which has to be in an experimental form, or some analytical expressions have to be checked because they are not given in details. Something or the other will have to be done out there as such. So literature survey is not the only thing when we think of projects as such. But projects are again not examined in one lot as such, in the sense or the projects, they may not be only at the end of the project examination. Examination may be there in two or three stages. Here we have it, even for BTech project, we normally have two stage examination. And so certain part he comes up with, he gives you a clear picture as to what he is going to do in the next phase, and next phase has to be matching with what he has told that he will be doing at the end of the first stage as well. So that is again something one has to look at. Presentation of a research paper. So many people nowadays, you are also getting more chances to attend the conferences as well as the present papers in the conferences. And there, if you look at it, look at yourself as an examiner for that paper, then the questions will come up more as such. More questions will click than thinking that he is presenting something and I am just listening to him as such. If you have that attitude, and that needs to be there, for most of the teachers that has to be there as such. In most cases it is there, but sometimes it is not vibrant as such. So that has to be brought in, and one has to look at it and ask the questions. There the response is in a different way. The person who is presenting the paper, everyone is looking at him as an expert, and you are asking a question to an expert as such, so to say. So whatever you tell, you have to accept it. No, it's not that. If you have form and if you are having the proper reasoning, a lot of discussion takes place in the conferences also, and people do accept that yes, he has made some mistake in the paper, and people are of that type that they do accept their mistakes as. But the questions have to be put up. My idea in putting this research paper out here is, when you are putting the question to a research paper presenter as such, you have to be at certain level. There is no doubt that you are a B first year student is not going to ask the proper question. Maybe your question may turn out to be wrong altogether, may not be pertaining to that particular part or so. But at least those things will become clear. But when you have understood a specific part, certainly the question should be put up, and if any explanation is possible within that short time period, one should try to extract that as such. The paper part and research proposal part, these are not the same thing as such. These are totally two different aspects. What I am talking about a research proposal is, nowadays I am hearing that World Bank has given a good amount of grant to different colleges, to government, and tech whip and things of that kind. You are buying a lot of equipment and things of that kind to tech whip points and so on. So they are giving it only for lab setup as such. There are other agencies like DST, AICT who are also giving you funding for supporting different projects. So when it goes in the form of a research proposal, no one else is going to examine it for you. Okay, finally those experts, the proposals will go to some experts, they will put their comments. But while writing this proposal, we have to become our own examiners at that stages. And what are the things which can be asked? Have I explained the things properly at that stage or not? Things of that kind have to be taken into account. Otherwise, a proposal may not turn out to be a good proposal. The topic or the actual work content is not what I am talking. Once you are putting something in a proper fashion, then only it will be looked at in a proper fashion and enough weightage will be given to that asset. Lastly, a presentation of an idea for a new patent. I am again not talking as a applicant for the patent application as such. I am looking at you people as examiners for patents. And the roles are totally different. The person who is the applicant is going to give you certain details and may still like to hold back certain things as such. May not tell you all. But when you are a research, the patent examiner as such, that time the questions which should come, you are not going to ask these questions to anyone. You are the one to set the questions for yourself and you are the one who is going to answer them and also weigh them and finally put that evaluation for that patent, that it should be accepted or not accepted kind of thing. I think you have yes, no type. Okay, like we have here, we have earlier also and now also we do have these kind of things. We have NCC course. Okay, we have social science and those certain parts are out there as such. So there are certain parts which are only pass or not pass. Okay, so there is no reasoning given out there as such. And that is a requirement that if you have not completed NCC for 2 years, you are not eligible to continue further as such. So one has to do that. Okay, but how those things are graded, exactly everything cannot be put at one particular level as such. All different courses, all different types as I have put right from quizzes, going right up to a new patent idea or some such thing, has to be looked at in a different way. Let's come to the setting of questions and question paper. I am putting it as a slash out there because I want to differentiate between the two things as such. A question and question paper, the two are not the same as such. As soon as I think of exam, the first thing which has to come to my mind is the course content which has to be planned for a particular test. Now, as I was introduced, my area is refrigeration, air conditioning and cryogenics. And a few examples a little bit later may be coming from refrigeration side. Very simple ones, but those may be properly understood or not. I will have to look at it little bit later as such. But when I am trying to fix the exam schedule and things of that kind, right from that time I must have in my mind what is the course content which I am going to put for this particular test as such, the test under consideration as such. And whether I have informed the students that this is going to be the part which is going to be evaluated as such. Their emphasis has to be only on that particular part and they should not read the whole thing what has been taught up to that date or something. At times we say even this, that tomorrow morning is the test, today's part is included. In that case it is included. Okay, but you have to plan the thing. You are not going to set the question paper after today's lecture or some such thing. You are going to have that planning in mind and accordingly you are going to teach them. We have to also keep in mind your teaching should not get affected because you had set the test paper beforehand as such. That is something which at times happens because you don't have time. Friday afternoon last lecture and Monday first lecture is the test. You are not going to have the copy making machines available, Xerox machines available or something, and so you have to keep everything ready on Friday because by Monday morning you are not going to have time enough for doing that as such. And you are conducting something which is also included in the test. Is it a good practice or bad? That is something different. But if you have included that, you have to ensure that your test question should not affect the teaching of that particular small part of the course as such. That is something important as such. So the information has to be known to the students as to what exactly is going to be the portion which they have to cover for this particular test. And as I said, the thinking or planning process also has to start simultaneously in our mind. In what way I am going to set the question paper? What are, there are some other aspects also. There are some other aspects also, some of which the student should know beforehand, and that is the time available. Is it going to be half an hour or 20 minutes quiz, or is it going to be 1 hour test, or what exactly it's going to be? We even look at this part as well. The answer paper which you are going to give, should it be 12 pages or 8 pages or 16 pages? These are normally the numbers which we have out here, and a similar thing may be available in all other colleges. Am I going to give a 16 page paper for a exam which is going to be of 20 minutes? Is it really worth doing it? Or should I restrict myself to a 4-page supplement kind of paper for 1 hour test? There is something simultaneously, these things also happen. Knowingly or unknowingly, these things are going to work within our mind as such. But we have to be clear about it, because we are not going to buy the paper and put it. We are going to collect it from maybe the office of the department or some such thing, and unless we give some prior intimation to them, they may not be in position to provide you what exactly you need out there. The last line, as I have put out here, supplements. Whether supplements will be provided or not, that also is one of the things as such, which one can plan, and one should tell this thing before. Last minute you can't tell the student that no, you are not going to get supplement because I haven't brought any. That kind of answer is not going to work out well. It's going to put the students off, and you are also internally, you are also going to be disturbed that you didn't do the right thing at that very moment as such. So, but the student should know that. This doesn't mean that they should write or scribble it in very fine handwriting, in very small size or some such thing. You have to give them enough space. Maybe sometimes we set the papers in this fashion, that you write a question, leave some space, the space which you feel is appropriate for a question, leave only that much space. So they will have to restrict to that space, and then put a note right in the beginning that you are not going to get any supplement. You have to write answers within the spaces given out there. So that kind of thing also has to be thought of and indicated as well. Coming to the more important steps as such. What type of questions am I going to put as such? In a test, is it going to be two questions, two main questions and that's it? Or one main questions, or main question, and the other ones can be in smaller parts or bits as such? There can these be all one mark kind of questions, or is some calculations are involved in it? All such things have to be thought of. The portion on which the test is being conducted is the one which is going to give us some answers out of this. Like if I am going to have in semester test examination, only at most half the course may be there for the test. Based on that, maybe I can think of putting two sort of bigger questions and one question which also is equally weighted as such, but maybe in smaller parts, maybe containing objective type of things as such. So one has to think what type of questions. This again has to be looked at in additional ways as such, especially for engineering. As I said, we need to look at it in a slightly different way. We have different approaches for solving a particular problem. A few terms I am using from the earlier lecture as such, because those were used there, so I am aware that that particular lady also had used those particular terms. Here are the graphs available as such, charts available, tables available, nomograms available, drawings available. Okay, so based on what you are teaching, which particular course you are conducting, let me give you a brief idea out here as such. When I put a small question on a basic refrigeration cycle, I have the refrigerant properties which are available in the form of thermodynamic properties of property tables as such. There is a chart based on which again I can get each and everything out there as such. There may be equations which are fitted to those property values as such. There may be a computer program which is already available and made available to the students, and there may be additional software the inside of that I also might not be knowing. Okay, so all such things are there as such. Now when I am setting a half an hour question paper and only two questions to be given, what exactly the student should do. I need to think about it before setting the question assignment. If I am asking them to use the property tables and do all the calculations, I know that it is going to take more time. If I allow them to use the chart instead, they have to know the chart well, but the time required is not going to be large, because once they know how exactly to get to various different points, they will be able to pick up the property values from there and use it. Third thing, equations. Types of equations, if I am going to give them say 5 degree equation for enthalpy value or any pressure value as function of temperature or vice versa, it is going to take long time to come up with one value. Do I leave the whole thing to them, whatever you want to solve it, but then the basis or reference level is changing. I must evaluate all the students with some ground level or reference level as such. I can't give them all different options. If I am giving them options, if the students have forgotten a chart, I must be in position to provide a chart at that moment. Afterwards, I can shout at him. But at that moment, I must be prepared with additional charts and must provide steam tables, charts, all such things. I must have a few of them when I conduct a test for 60 or 80 students at a time as such. At least 3-4 of them. More than that, maybe you can't do it for everyone. Otherwise, you have to provide the chart along with the question. So it's not that we need to do it for everyone, but we need to take care of these aspects as well as such. And when I am doing it, I need to now decide whether I should allow the student to use only the charts or only the tables or only the nomograms or only the equations. And based on that, I must give a common test to everyone. Then only my evaluation is going to be proper, the assessment of the things is going to be proper as such. Do I give steps? There are going to be steps involved for each problem as such. Any numerical or some such thing is not going to be a single step procedure as such. It's going to have a large number of steps at times only a few major steps, and some values have to be looked at from the chart or tables or some such thing. So do I put equal marks for each one of them, or how exactly do I handle that situation? Should the sub-question wise breakup be provided or not? There is something which is very typical. When I give an analysis of vapor compression cycle or a particular system out there, I keep on asking what is the efficiency, what is the work input, what is the heat rejected, what is the heat added, what is the composition. I know that I have split the main question into 10 different small sections as such. And I may put them in order or may not put them in order, because when you are starting the solution, you know what is the first parameter to be calculated. Do I put it as A, B, C, D, or do I put A, Z, B, C, F, Z, whatever, mix up them and put it and make it a little bit more complicated, or should I put them in a very specific order, the way I will be solving the question, should I put it exactly in the same order and give them idea that if you can do this, the next thing is going to be possible. If you are not able to do this, next thing most likely is not going to be possible to calculate or some such thing. So this involves the evaluation part and whether we should give the marks for each one of them separately or should I put 10 marks total. 10 parts, 10 marks, but some of them may be having only half of mark and not 1 mark each. These things have to be known to the students also. From our side, we try to do it, but that is not enough because that will cause creeps from the students after the evaluation. The students will come back to you, I have done 5 parts correct, but I have not been given 5 marks out of 10. I have been given only 3, and then you have to tell him though these 2 had only half mark, these 4 had only quarter marks together. That will not be a good practice. So they should at least know that each broken up question may not have the equal weightage as such. At least that much has to be known to the students as such. Finally, why all this we are doing? It's to see whether the expected output really comes from the students or not. You have told, you have taught them certain portion, you have given them some ideas how to handle the problems, you have set the question paper properly, keeping all the above aspects in mind, And finally, after evaluation, you need to know whether the students are doing well, whatever your ideas were, have those been transformed and worked out in practices or not. Or you have taught n number of things and they have been stuck at the first step and none of them is able to move further or something. So that is something they need to know, as we also need to know. And so the evaluation process also has to be kept in mind, and we have to also keep in mind that we have to give the feedback to the students once we finish this. Let's get back to the specific areas in which we are interested as such. Okay, this was basically a sort of introductory aspect as such which I had in mind, that unless I say something about this exam part or the things, we will not be able to look at it in a little bit more detail as such. So let's look at the four different disciplines I have mentioned out here. They are not necessarily only four, there may be many more. I have tried to touch upon only these four of them as such. So what are these? Creative arts, creative design, medical science, architecture, and our part is already kept out here as such at the top, the engineering. Okay, so that's not part of these different things. Why I put these very specifically out here will become more and more clear as we look at them one by one. So the creative arts and design, now I am trying to combine the two as such, arts and design. The different forms of arts, I have not included here the music or dance or that kind of categories out here. But something which can be seen in the form of hard thing as such, like we say hard copy, soft copy. I should have something hard copy kind of thing, only then I can get it evaluated by 10 different persons and look at whether I can get the same assessment for all of them or something different comes in as such. And so I start with the first part as such. Right? Look at any painting. I am not a real appreciator of these things. I really am unable to appreciate certain things as such, and I am telling you all that, but I have given some thinking to this part as well. How exactly the things should happen as such. When it comes to the mind of the painter or artist, he has to think about the thing. Everyone wants to put his ideas and in different ways, as we say dance drama and then painting and models and sculptures. All these are the avenues through which one can put himself open before others as such. So theme is something, once he decides on the theme, right now there are many things, many cartoons and other things also you get seen around as such. Lot of discussion is taking place about the nuclear treaty and things of that kind. Simultaneously the Ganesh festival was there, the cricket match also was there on the same resurgent day, and things are, all of them are coming in. And 2 days back I saw something in the Times of India which tried to combine all these three in one part as such, and I couldn't really make out what exactly is that picture showing as such. But let me put it that the artist has something in his mind. So he looks at the theme, decides on the theme, he has to put it in a very proper size of paper or maybe canvas, as canvas size as we normally term it in terms of our engineering drawing part as such. The different color combination schemes he has to use, all these things he is doing it. And later on if I am shown that, I am most probably, if it is a very good painting, I am most probably not going to like it as such, because that's not fitting in my requirements as such. Why this happens, I am come to that also little bit later as such. Come to another artist as such who makes either sculptures or models as such. Models, when we are looking at, we are looking at models in the sense of engineering more systems models or things of that kind I am talking of. Here there are certain aspects which the person thinks as such. What is the material I should be using? Should it be scaled model or the like Ganpati, a big tummy and a small ear or some small eyes, or should it be looking neat, proportionate kind of thing? Should it be like a scale drawing, as we say? Should it be something on that line in that case, which can be looked at by anyone, and one can get a fair idea as to what the person is trying to do. Only thing is, it's a model, and so it's not going to be always to the size as such, not 1:1 scale as we call it. Not every time the model has to be small. Not every time the model has to be small. The model can be bigger than the actual object as well. So things of that kind, and finally the specific purpose to be demonstrated. So every time it may not be an art part as such, it may be something engineering part which is to be demonstrated through use of model or something. And we are all aware that while teaching engineering drawing or some such thing, we always, at least our teachers used to carry, and I did it in the first 2 years when I taught engineering drawing in mechanical department. Here the system is not much different. The junior person goes through that. Okay, so I also gone through that part as such, and we used to take the cut sections of the cone and things of that kind. So those are models. Okay, nothing is specific about them. You have seen it a ten number of times, but when you are trying to explain the things, as in the last lecture, I heard the term touch and feel. Yes, that is something which gives you a clear idea after seeing the things, what exactly is the work going on and things of that kind. So those are also some of the things which has to be looked at. Sculptures, again, some thematic idea are there. I saw at IPCL Nagottede, where we were conducting some course, a nice stone carved into a shape of fish at the top of that globe kind of thing fixed. Nothing is in parts, it's an integral object. I like that very much. But I don't know what exactly gave me that decision that I'm liking it as such. What I'm coming to is, when we are looking at these creative arts and designs, everyone's perception is different. It need not match with immediate next person as such. Okay. And with that, either you are going to like it or not. We have so many color combination schemes as I was talking about. Yesterday I learned that when presenting a lecture out here, one should have a darkish color shirt. Otherwise, the contrast and other thing will not match. That was not my requirement, but I agreed to that and tried to do that part as such. So some of these things are requirement based. Some of these things are choice based. Had I been given an option whether to go for a half shirt or a full sleeve shirt, this is a formal part, I would have come in full sleeve shirt, that's fine. But at some other place, I would have gone for something else. So all these things, liking something very specific, it's at that moment, it's not going to be again a fixed idea, a fixed notion all the time. Today something which I am liking, I may not like it after 10 days. Okay. I have not seen anything as a competitor for that part. But that time my mood may be different, my thinking may be on different lines, and I may not appreciate what I appreciated 10 days earlier as such. So these are the things which happen with these creative arts and design. The evaluators of these have to be very careful, and they have to ensure that their thought processes don't change with time, like mine can change. They, as evaluators, their thought process should not change, and they must take into account certain specific things as such. Coming to another discipline as such, medical science. It's very much different than us, and it's a most of the time the information is very case specific as such. What exactly happened to a patient? Finally, patient is the god for the doctor as such. He is the person who is going to make the payments, and otherwise the doctor has, again, even if he is not charging him, he is the one whom he has to cure. Whether it's with good moral values or good finance part, either way he is the person whom he has to cure as such. And the analysis is based on the specific current conditions as such. At that time, what exactly are the conditions? The generalization is the one which follows as such. Based on this, that if this happens, this is normally the output, and so this should be the conclusion. So that kind of generalization occurs. And once that generalization occurs, one again comes back to specific cases as such. So it looks for certain specific things, as I tried to indicate out here, the blood test, X-rays, CAT scans, all these terms we are all aware of. Okay, if given, I may not be able to make out anything from a given X-ray. Maybe that may be belonging to my own bone, but I may not be able to make out anything from that. You need that background information and all that. But what is a doctor doing at that time? He is using either the confirmation or the deletion. One of these two processes are there in his mind at that time as well. If you get something specific, he is either going to confirm. If it doesn't get that, he cannot say that that is still not there. He may have to go for additional test and then reconfirm it as such. Like talking about these aspects as such, presently there is a dengue thing which is going on as such. And when I was talking to an environmentalist recently, Professor Asolekar from IIT Bombay itself, he says these mosquitoes are very typical. I said, what is the difference between different mosquitoes? All of them can cause malaria. Then he told that this particular category grows in clean environment only. And my idea till that time was mosquitoes grow only in dirty environment. If something is dirty, there the mosquitoes grow. But those are different type of mosquitoes. The present dengue thing which is there in the newspapers pertains to the clean areas where these mosquitoes are. So solutions are going to depend on the options which you are going to have. I am not aware of that. So I am going to look at it, maybe spray DDT as a solution, ensure that no more mosquitoes are around or something. But these are getting generated in the clean area itself. Now what do I do? Things are not so very simple as such. So one will have to look at that particular class. So what I am trying to put before you out here is, medical science is something which is very case specific. They look at one particular case and try to analyze it to the fullest extent as such. As we say threadbare, they want to do that threadbare analysis and then come out with the solution as well. It's not only the analysis that is enough, they have to give you the solution to that as well. Coming to our discipline, the engineering discipline as such. We normally do not agree that this is similar to any other discipline, and that's the reason why I have tried to put from my side what are the differences. They may not be all, they may not be all correct either. Okay, but some of the things which I thought I should put. For a given problem, any specific problem, we may have different methods as such. As I indicated a few minutes back, I can go for a solution through chart method, the equation method, the tables method. There is some simple example as such. But I can have different solutions or different methods are possible as such. But what I expect is the solution should finally turn out to be the same. If I am getting 10 different solutions for an engineering problem, something is wrong somewhere. And so that gives us something more specific compared to the other disciplines which I talked about. Medical discipline or creative arts and design and things of that kind, the two examiners may give the equal marks for two different models or things of that kind. Here, two different answer sheets, if the answer is not the same, they are not going to get equal marks. If they are followed exactly the same steps and getting different answers, they are certainly not going to get equal marks. Who gets what? The marks may turn out to be equal only if that stepwise marking comes in as such. Otherwise, the things are not going to be there. But what I am looking at is, the solution has to be unique, but under the same set of constraints. And that means I must provide some additional constraints in order to ensure that the answer remains same as such. I can't say that A plus B equal to something and B value I am not giving, A value I am not giving, and now you find out A and B. There can be multiple solutions in that case. Okay, but then some constraint has to be put in. So one has to look at that particular aspect as well. Just now, as I said, that we must get a unique solution for a unique or a given problem as such. Why this happens is, most of the problems are related to analysis or design of some system or a subsystem, and these are being considered under some constraints as such. Again, when we are looking at these aspects as such, our main aim all the time is functionality, maybe of a very small subsystem or a small component of subsystem. But functionality is always at the back of our mind. We may not say it openly or all the time, or will not advertise that we talk about functionality all the time as such. But the creative arts part, they are the models which we have, and the engineering models we have, there's a difference in this power message. Here we are looking at something specific being expected from each and every object which is created, whether it's a form of model or a small component or a small screw or threads, threaded portion as such, each one of them gives us some functionality. And so the criteria for rejection or acceptance is the functionality, whether it works or it will not work. Theoretically or practically, again that's an additional feature, but theoretically if you are putting some design, whether it's acceptable. If you are looking at an assembly of components as such, and that assembly seems to be impossible, you are showing something, a sphere inside a sphere, okay, and you are saying that the whole thing is inner sphere also is an integral part, outer sphere also is an integral part. How am I going to put that inner sphere inside? It's not going to be a feasible solution. So something feasible and not feasible, that again our interest is always towards these things. Like if I look at the electrical engineering, one small part as such, you are talking nowadays about the superconducting materials as such. If you say that I am going to heat the material to 400 Kelvin, ambient is at 300 K, and I should be getting superconductivity, no one is going to expect that it will work at any time as such. Because above ambient, the things have not been noticed as yet to work as superconducting. Maybe at helium temperatures, liquid nitrogen temperatures, yes. But saying that I am going to heat it up and then thereby I am going to get the material converted to a superconducting material, no one is going to accept that kind of. So certain things are totally being considered as out of scope to get started itself. In general, the second aspect which we have for the engineering part as such, and here there is a small difference of opinions as such, but this is what normally happens as such. The aesthetics of the product, we normally don't give much weightage as such, not till the system functions in the first instance. Whereas we have another department out here, industrial design center. The thing will be, yes, functionality is your problem, but how it will look good or how it will be more effective, more acceptable to a customer, consumer, that is our lookout as such. So lookouts are different. One has to accept these parts as such. And so one has to see that mainly when we look at it as engineering problems or thing, we look at the product functionality, aesthetics and other thing are not the ones which we are looking at. So what is going to be our acceptance criteria in general for any particular part? Output of the system, if I am going to design a system, it's going to be the output, that is the quantum of output as such, efficiency of the system. And then I start looking at more things as such, trying to go for more details, availability criteria. If I am going to make something out of gold and cost limit is there, I am not going to be in position to do that as such. So the cost criteria comes in, the availability and cost in general, they get related, but not always. They do not get always related to each other. Sometimes cost may become a much lower criteria than the availability as such. Just to give an example, helium for example is available in our country as such, but it's all imported. Where do you get helium as such? Only two places, one is Russia and the other is America. There's no other big reserve which is available. How is it available? It's coming with the oil and natural gas. But we also have natural gas, so many wells we have, but it doesn't turn out to be available in our gas. Now it's something is specific, we can't help it. Something is naturally occurring, you are not getting part of it, not the share of it, neither the area wise nor the population proportion wise, can't do much about it. So what is the effect? It's available but at much higher cost, and we have to go by that. Similarly, the size and mass of the system are important. No system one would like to have a bulky system for no application as such. But certain dimensions, minimum mass of the system is going to be there, sir. Once all these things are taken care of, then finally comes the reliability part. Today the system is working nicely. Can I really consider it as reliable? Will the power supply be there till my session is over? or I had to wind up and get to another methodology of teaching as was being discussed in the morning as such. Some such things one has to start looking at and how they, these are the criteria. And finally, the life of the system. No system component is going to have infinite life as such. It may cause our life limit as such, but it's not going to be infinite life. Like this particular light or the bulb which is being used out there has a life of about 4000 hours. If 4000 hours they have already used it, they better be safe and have another bulb ready with them to replace that. So all these parameters, one goes for that. And so when we try to compare the disciplines, can I say that engineering practices are better than in other disciplines? Not me. I will not like to dare into that kind of argument as such. The approach and criteria for each discipline is different. And so we can't say that we are doing it like this, you also do it like this. No, we can't bully others to do that. But we have to understand that yes, engineering discipline is different than others. And so we have to have our own criteria of testing, evaluation, grading, conducting exams. All these parameters are to be taken into account as something different than what is applicable to a medical or the artistic approaches out there. So the conclusion from this discussion is basically